All members will come to the floor of the House. We're going to have the morning roll call here momentarily. We are about to have morning roll call. We're going to have the call of the roll. All members present will please vote green to signify their presence in the chamber, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted?
No, Mark Hamilton is running.
Have all members now voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will now lock the machines. Doorkeepers will please close the doors and keep them closed. Well, good morning, everyone. Yeah, I was thinking early this morning, today is legislative day 18. Do y'all realize that come Monday, we will be halfway through this session? Barring weather, of course. We're going to have scripture reading and prayer by the chaplain, after which we will pledge allegiance to the flag of our country. Our chaplain this morning will be introduced by the gentleman from the 1st House District, Representative Deffenbaugh, Representative John Deffenbaugh.
Good morning to you all. This is my first time from this position, and it looks great out there. When is the next election for this position?
I'm turning your mic off.
I think it might not have been that nice of a view, but anyway. Mr. Speaker and members of the House and visitors and guests that we have, it's a very distinct pleasure of mine to introduce you to a godly man this morning. But first, I'd like to introduce his family who has accompanied him here today. His wife, Kendra, and she's a Dade County girl, District 1, State of Dade. He has two sons. He has an 11-year-old Preston and an 8-year-old Bennett. They both enjoy soccer, basketball, football, and NASCAR. His father, Dr. Richard Allen, and his mother, Sarah Allen. Would you please welcome them? Doyle's family and our family have become very good friends over the years. When they first came to Lookout Mountain to live, it has been a pleasure to know them over the years. Doyle and my son became very good friends, and together they shared the ups and downs of high school days together at Chattanooga Christian School. Doyle attended Covenant College up on Lookout Mountain and in Dade County. And during that time, he spent a semester studying in the Czech Republic at the Pulaski University. He graduated from Covenant College in 1998. Shortly thereafter, he attended Covenant Theological Seminary located in St. Louis, which is associated with the college on Lookout. And he graduated there with a Master's of Divinity in 2005. He served PCA Church, which is a Presbyterian Church of America, in West Virginia for 4 years. While in West Virginia, he served also as a moderator or chairman of the local presbytery. When he finally saw the light and decided to return to God's country in Northwest Georgia, and now he's currently serving as a pastor of the First Presbyterian Church of Fort Oglethorpe. When I asked my son, Ethan, how he would describe Doyle from his childhood memories, and that was kind of questionable sometimes whether I could use anything, but he quickly stated that Doyle always presented himself as an example of Christ-like living, always kind and considerate of others. So without any further comments, I give you my pastor of the day, Reverend Doyle Allen.
Thank you, John. When you started talking about the ups and downs in high school, I also wanted to turn off your mic. But thanks. Thank you very much, John, and thank you, Mr. Speaker, for allowing us the privilege of being here this morning. On behalf of the congregation of First Presbyterian Church of Fort Oglethorpe, I'd like to express our thankfulness for this distinguished body. Having had one of our own serve in this house, we know well the cost and the sacrifices you make as you guide and as you guard this great state. We pray for you often, we do, that God would sustain you, your faith, your marriages, your children, your grandchildren, your friendships, especially as the responsibilities and the temptations and the pressures of your office often threaten to squeeze these most important parts of our lives to the very edges of our lives. And on behalf of Boy Scout Troop 52, which began in our church, although our church was not in that particular building at the time, but it began in Fort Oglethorpe nearly 100 years ago. I asked the young men what they would like me to express to you, and they would like me to thank you for your duty and your service to God, the state, and the country. On Sunday, we had the youth group of our church over to our home to celebrate Groundhog's Day. Now, there just happened to be a football game on TV that night, and most of the kids, though, weren't interested in that football game, and they talked and they texted on their phones and they played other games. But as soon as the commercials came on TV, all of that came to a screeching halt, and every eye became glued on the television because they wanted to see the commercials. And there were some okay commercials this year, but none of them compared to my favorite commercial of all time. My favorite commercial of all time is actually a Snickers commercial, and it shows a quarterback getting absolutely pulverized by a giant defensive lineman, and he lays motionless on the ground. The training staff and the head coach come running out to the field, and they start assessing him, I guess, for some sort of concussion, and they ask him a series of questions, and they say, "Are you okay?" And he said, "Yeah, I'm okay." "Where are you?" "I'm in New York." Who am I?" the coach says. And he says, "You're coach." And they have one more question for him, and they say, "Who are you?" And he looks at them with all seriousness and says, "I'm Batman." And so they, of course, take him out of the game. It's a good commercial. It's a great commercial. But it brings up an even better question. Each of us, at some time in our life must ask the question, who am I? Because the answer to this question will have a profound impact on how we see ourselves, but also how we see other people, especially those people that are different from us, or maybe that are difficult to us. It will also change how we lead, how we manage disagreement, how we engage debate, how we legislate. The great theologian Emil Brunner put it best when he said, "The most powerful of all spiritual forces is a man's or woman's view of himself, the way in which he understands his nature and his destiny. Indeed, it is the one force which determines all the others which influence him." It's a question so basic and fundamental that the Bible even starts out with it. In Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 27, the Bible says, "God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them." So, according to the Bible, everything else in all creation was made after its own kind, but human beings were made after the image and in the likeness of God. This is who you are. You don't just have the image of God. You are the image of God in body and in soul, male and female. From the youngest to the oldest, from the most prominent homes on Lookout Mountain to the most overlooked neighborhoods of Atlanta, from the chairman of the most important committee to the most overlooked intern or page. All people are made in the image of God. Each of us is created, designed, and commissioned to reflect the identity and the character of our Creator, to show His way of doing things, to show His way of loving others. In fact, the Bible goes so far as to describe us as works of art. In chapter 2 of the book of Genesis, the Bible depicts our Creator as a master sculptor. Even before any plant had yet grown or rain yet fallen, God sent streams to water the dirt. And He combines the water and the dirt, forms this kind of clay-ish substance. We can use our imaginations to see this happening. And then with His own hands, He forms the first human being, and He breathes life into him. And then, as you or I might stand back and admire Michelangelo's statue of David, God stands back, looks at what He created, and says, "That is very good." So this is who you are. This is who your next opponent is. This is who the people in your district are. No matter what they say about you, no matter what they've done to you, no matter how badly your life might be coming off the rails right now, no matter if 10,000 people vote for you or just 10, you have dignity. You have value because you are made in the image of God. You're a work of art. You're a masterpiece. You are very good. But sometimes we don't see ourselves this way, do we? Sometimes it's hard to see other people this way. When we look around and look at ourselves, it seems something has gone terribly wrong with those created in the image of God. In fact, influential psychologist Carl Rogers, at the end of a career that allowed him to counsel tens of thousands of people, he said most of the problems that he encountered had one common characteristic. He said the central core difficulty in people, as I have come to know them, is that in the great majority of cases, they despise themselves. And they regard themselves as worthless and unlovable. Even though we're made in the image of God, and even though everyone has value far exceeding the most cherished works of art, deep down in the most secret places of our soul, we feel worthless, we feel unlovable, we feel unacceptable by God and others. It may come from our own deliberate rebellion, shameful failures, or embarrassing weaknesses, or it may come from the havoc and destruction caused in our lives by the thoughtlessness, carelessness, or wickedness of others. Either way, the result is the same. We feel like we've got something to hide. In his book, We Learn Nothing, Tim Kreider calls our attempts to hide the most embarrassing part of our lives, those parts that make us feel unlovable and unacceptable, he calls them our soul toupees. Now, maybe this resonates with me because of my own follicle challenges, but he says a soul toupee, we are all like a man with the worst toupee imaginable. We're all trying to hide that thing about ourselves that we're most deeply embarrassed by, and we're trying to hide it behind a comical sponge-like square of hair that's pasted to our heads. Each one of us has a soul toupee, but each one of our soul toupees is different. It could be vote totals. It could be arguments won, control gained, no matter the cost. It could be budget items approved, amendments added, laws passed, or applause won. We seek these things out. We pursue them with religious fury. We convince ourselves that we've got the world fooled, that they won't see the most embarrassing part of us. But in reality, like a bad toupee, we know that it's just not working. And deep down, we know, or perhaps that we fear, that God's not fooled either. But this is the beauty of it. God sees the most embarrassing part of our lives. He sees all the shame we are desperate to keep hidden because we're afraid that it will make us unlovable and unacceptable. He sees it. He doesn't minimize it, excuse it, ignore it. Even our soul toupees are plainly and painfully obvious to him. And yet he doesn't throw up his hands and walk away as if he refuses to be associated with such failures. Instead, he sees and he remembers our value. We still bear his image. We may lie in ruin because of our rebellion or the wickedness of other people, but we are still his masterpieces. We are still his treasured works of art. Therefore, he sends the most treasured and valuable part of himself. He sends his son, who the Bible describes as a second and better Adam, that first human being that was created. Jesus is a second and better Adam. Everywhere that Adam failed, Christ succeeded. The Bible also describes Jesus as the image of the invisible God who, through death and resurrection, frees all who cling to him by faith from the penalty and power of sin so that we might be restored and transformed with ever-increasing glory, the Bible says, into the image and likeness of God that we see in the face of Jesus. And so may you, on this day, was it Legislative Day 18? May you on this day know that you are the image of God. You are a treasured work of art. And may you be protected from the temptation to feel that your approval and your acceptability to your peers and to your Creator is measured by performance or vote totals, so that you are free to serve and lead your families, your constituents, and the great state of Georgia without fear. Would you stand and join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, I thank you for the works of art that I have the privilege of meeting today. I thank you for your love for them in Christ. Would you bless their socks off today? As bearers of God's image, of bearers of your image, would you give them wisdom to guard and guide our state with justice and equality? Would you give them wisdom to turn disagreement into dialogue and dialogue into progress? As bearers of your image, would you give them courage when the right thing is the hard thing? Would you give them courage to know that criticism is no indication of their value in your eyes? Would you give them compassion for the people of this state and the others in this room? Would you give them compassion that allows them to keep from treating others and their opponents as obstacles? Would you give them strength in the face of the temptation of their positions? Would you give them strength in the face of the temptations and the loneliness that come when they miss home so badly? Would you give them rest in the midst of crazy, busy schedules, countless handshakes, countless grip and grins? Would you give them rest for their taxed minds and emotions, their worn out bodies, and their worried hearts? Heavenly Father, in the name of Christ, I ask that you would bless them today. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you pledge allegiance to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Doorkeepers will unlock the doors. Chair recognizes Chairman Chokas, the chair of the Committee on Information and Audits.
Good morning, Mr. Speaker. Your Committee on Information and Audits have reviewed the journals of the previous legislative day and have found them to be correct.
Chairman Chokas, the chair of the Committee on Information and Audits, reports that the journal of the previous legislative day has been read and found to be correct. Is there any objection to the confirmation of the journal? The chair hears none, and the journal is confirmed. The clerk will read the resolution establishing the order of business for the day.
Mr. O'Neill, the 146 moves that the following be established as the order of business during the first part of the period of unanimous consent. Introduction of bills and resolutions. First reading and reference of House bills and resolutions. Second reading of bills and resolutions. Report of standing committees. Third reading and passage of uncontested local bills and resolutions. First reading and reference of Senate bills and resolutions. Morning orders.
Trucks trying to help people get home, and they were providing something for them. It brought this passage.
Is there any objection to the adoption of the resolution establishing the order of business for the day? The chair hears none, and the resolution is adopted. First reading of bills and resolutions. The clerk will read.
House Bill 921 by Representative Dollar of the 45th to amend Code Section 36-62-5, the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to the powers and duties of directors and officers of developmental authorities.
Budget and Fiscal Affairs Oversight.
House Bill 922 by Representative Harbin of the 122nd to amend Code Section 48-7-27 of the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to computation of taxable net income for Georgia income tax purposes.
Ways and Means.
House Bill 923 by Representative Coomer of the 14th to amend Article 11 of Chapter 11 of Title 15, Chapter 15 and Title 19, and Article 1, Chapter 3, Title 35 of the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to the Georgia Child Advocate for the Protection of Children Act.
Juvenile Justice.
House Bill 924 by Representative Scott of the 76th to amend Code Section 39-5-2 relating to notification of subscribers of products.
Juvenile Justice.
House Bill 925 by Representative Martin of the 49th to amend Code Section 10-1-664.1 of the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to restrictions on the ownership, operation, or control of motor vehicle dealerships.
Motor Vehicles.
House Bill 926 by Representative Stevens of the 164th to amend Chapter 80 of Title 36, the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to the general provisions applicable to counties, municipal corporations, and other governmental entities.
State Planning and Community Affairs.
House Bill 927 by Representative Stevens of the 164th to amend Chapter 88 of Title 36, the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to enterprise zones.
Economic Development and Tourism.
House Bill 928 by Representative Knight of the 130th to amend Code Section 44-7-53, the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to the issuance of a writ of possession.
Judiciary.
House Bill 929 by Representative Barr of the 103rd to amend Chapter 1 of Title 50, the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to general provisions regarding state government.
Judiciary.
House Bill 930 by Representative Barr of the 103rd to amend Chapter 1 of Title 50 of the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to general provisions regarding state government.
Judiciary.
House Bill 931 by Representative Mitchell of the 88th to amend Code Section 16-3-23.1 of the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to no duty to retreat.
Judiciary non-civil.
House Bill 932 by Representative Holcomb of the 81st to amend Chapter 80 of Title 36, the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to provisions applicable to county, municipal corporations, and other governmental entities.
Governmental Affairs.
House Resolution by Representative Dickey honoring the life of Mr. Carlton Harmon Bud Sledge.
Transportation.
House Resolution 1236 by Representative Hardin of the 148th honoring the life of Special Agent Larry Paul Collins.
Transportation.
House Resolution 1237 by Representative Hardin of the 148th honoring the life of Trooper First Class James Keith Stewart Jr.
Transportation.
House Resolution 1238 by Representative Holt of the 112th honoring the life of Trooper First Class Keith Harlan Sewell.
Transportation.
House Resolution 1239 by Representative Dollar of the 45th, creating the House Development Authority Study Committee.
Budget and Fiscal Affairs Oversight.
House Resolution 1240 by Representative Roberts, dedicating a road in the honor of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Transportation.
That completes first readings.
Second reading of bills and resolutions, the clerk will read.
HB 908 by Representative Riley of the 50th, a bill relating to tire disposal restrictions. HB 909 by Representative England of the 116th, a bill to amend an act incorporating the city of Winder. HB 910 by Representative Kelly of the 16th, a bill relating to the powers, duties, functions, responsibilities of the Department of Community Health. HB 911 by Representative Ballinger of the 23rd, a bill relating to assault and battery. HB 912 by Representative Buckner of the 137th, a bill to amend an act incorporating the city of Manchester. HB 913 by Representative Kelly of the 16th, a bill relating to the Board of Community Health. HB 914 by Representative Wilkerson of the 38th, a bill relating to child abuse and deprivation records. HB 915 by Representative Clark of the 98th, a bill relating to identity theft. HB 916 by Representative Powell of the 171st, a bill to provide a new charter for the city of Baconton. HB 917 by Representative Strickland of the 111th, a bill relating to foreclosure. HB 918 by Representative Peake of the 141st, a bill relating to revenue and taxation. HB 919 by Representative Teasley of the 37th, a bill relating to alternative ad valorem tax on motor vehicles. HB 920 by Representative Teasley of the 37th, a bill relating to life insurance. House Resolution 1225 by Representative Donahue of the 30th, resolution honoring the life of Corporal Tyrone Collier Dillard and dedicating a road in his memory. H.R. 1226 by Representative Williams of the 119th, a resolution honoring the life of Deputy David W. Gilstrap, dedicating a road in his memory. Senate Bill 240 by Senator Hill of the 6th, a bill relating to the sale of alcoholic beverages. Senate Bill 273 by Senator Burke of the 11th, a bill relating to the Department of Public Health. Senate Bill 283 by Representative Senator Duggan of the 30th, a bill relating to competencies and core curriculum. Senate Resolution 736 by Senator Staten of the 18th, a resolution applying for a convention of the states under Article 5 of the United States Constitution, through second readers.
Reports of standing committees, the clerk will read.
Representative Jan Tankersley, the 160th District Chairman of the Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination has had under consideration the following bills of the House. It has instructed me to report the same back to the House with the following recommendations. House Bill 888, do pass. House Bill 893, do pass. House Bill 896, do pass. House Bill 901, do pass. House Bill 905, do pass. House Bill 906, do pass. Respectfully submitted, Representative Jan Tankersley of the 160th District. Representative Smith of the 70th District, Chairman of the Committee on Natural Resources and Environment, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Natural Resources and Environment has had under its consideration the following bill of the House and has instructed me to report the same back to the House with the following recommendation. House Bill 741, do pass by committee substitute. Respectfully submitted, Representative Lynn Smith of the 70th District.
All right, we're about to go on to the local calendar. We are about to go on to the local calendar. This House will now come to order. This House will be in order. We have a local calendar today. Third reading and passage of uncontested local bills. Two bills on the local calendar relate to homestead exemption and require a recorded two-thirds roll call vote for passage. If there is no objection, we will vote on the local calendar as a whole with a recorded vote. Hearing none, it is so ordered. The clerk will read the local calendar.
House Bill 896 by Representative Beverly, the 143rd, Bibb County. House Bill 901 by Representative Dickerson of the 113th, Newton County. House Bill 905 by Representative Holcomb of the 81st, DeKalb County. House Bill 907 by Representative Holcomb of the 81st, DeKalb County. House Bill 888 by Representative Holt of the 112th, Morgan County. House Bill 893 by Representative Beverly, the 143rd, Bibb County.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered on the local calendar? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bills? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall the bills on the local calendar now pass? All those in favor of the passage of the bills will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of the bills on the local calendar. The ayes are 155, the nays are zero. These bills, having received the requisite constitutional majority, are therefore passed. House will continue to be at order. Chair recognizes Representative Pizzo to introduce the doctors of the day.
Good to see you. Good morning. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Eugene Schauffler. Now, you'll see this lovely lady next to him. This is Dr. Margaret Schauffler. She is the more beautiful of the Schauffler doctor duo. Dr. Eugene Schauffler, with all due respect, of course, Dr. Eugene Schauffler is a trained OBGYN and is a member of the Medical Association of Georgia and the Troup County Medical Society, and he likes long walks on the beach and sunsets. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you all for that wonderful presentation. It's a privilege this morning to address this body. As mentioned, I'm Eugene Michael Schauffler, and this is my wife, Margaret Schauffler, and we practice in LaGrange, Georgia. We recently became part of West Georgia Health. We are office gynecologists and have retired from the baby business. I was born a Yankee, but I'm a Georgian by choice. And I don't want any male members of the group to be intimidated to see two or one gynecologist this morning if you have any complaints. And we would, we are most proud of y'all with the work that you do for the citizens of Georgia and also for the doctors of Georgia. Thank you for having us here today.
Thank you. You did good.
Okay, we're going on to morning orders. We're going on to morning orders. House will be at order. House will be at order. We have a number of members who have signed up for morning orders this morning. Chair is going to limit, strictly limit, morning orders to 2 minutes each. 2 minutes each on the morning orders. Chair recognizes for a morning order, Chairman Katie Dempsey. Chairman Dempsey for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Good morning. I just want to remind everybody that tomorrow's a very important day. It's Wear Red for Women Day. Very important focus on the challenges of cancer and the way that they are being addressed. So look in your closets, look in your ties, see if you can also wear a little red tomorrow. Thank you.
Chair recognizes for a morning order. Looks like the Bullock County delegation, Chairman Burns, Chairman Parrish, Chairman Tankersley for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and good morning, fellow legislators. We have a really great group from Southeast Georgia here today, and I wanted to introduce part of them, and Representative Parrish, Chairman, will do the remainder. But a very progressive part of our state is Bullock County, Georgia, and part of that leadership is here today, Bullock Leadership. The class for this year is here, and I wish you would stand and let us recognize the Bullock Leadership class. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And in addition to recognizing the folks in the gallery from Bullock County, I want you to stop by on the second floor and visit with all our friends from Georgia Southern. If you haven't had an opportunity to do that, you'll get an opportunity to learn a lot about one of the great universities of this state. So please stop by on the second floor and visit. And we're glad to have them here today with us. Thank you.
Chair recognizes for a morning order Representative Alicia Thomas Morgan. Representative Morgan.
Good morning, members of the House. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise this morning to voice my strong support for Common Core Georgia Performance Standards. I first want to thank the families of Georgia for entrusting us to ensure a strong education for your children and one that allows them to compete with any student from anywhere at any time. I also want to thank our state leaders who have shepherded this initiative over the last 5 years, as well as the Georgia Chamber of Commerce, 100 Black Men, Georgia Coalition for the People's Agenda, Georgia PTA, and a host of other organizations. Many businesses, civic and education stakeholders who have endorsed Common Core. I want to thank our state's teachers and principals for their due diligence in implementing these standards and doing the work to ensure that Georgia's 1.6 million students are prepared for both college and career. There have been a lot of arguments on both sides of this issue, but the one thing I know is that we can all agree that we want to do what's best for kids. So I stand here today to say that I believe that Georgia's Common Core state standards are what's best for children. As a proud mom of a first grader in Cobb County Public Schools, I can see how Common Core works at the kitchen table. I watched Layla use her critical thinking skills, and I'm amazed at what a first grader is required to know now. And I know that I'm not alone. This past fall, I joined my colleagues in the House Education Committee to participate in a statewide listening tour with our Senate Education colleagues, talking to parents, students, principals, school board members, administrators, superintendents, and many community stakeholders about what's happening in our state education system. Listen, as we did, to those on the front lines, our teachers and our school leaders, most of whom who will tell you that Common Core is working in the classroom. In the coming days, I will be introducing an urging resolution, and I want to ask my colleagues to join me in signing the resolution and supporting it. I'm offering this because it's a critical time for education in Georgia, and as leaders of this state, we're obligated to give our teachers and education professionals the certainty they need to do the jobs they've been hired to do, making sure our children are prepared with the skills and knowledge necessary to compete in the 21st century workforce. Likewise, we have to make good on our promise to ensure that every child in Georgia graduates from high school, college, and career ready, and honoring all the work and resources we've contributed as a state to implement Common Core. Lastly, I will say, let's support Common Core and do what's in the best interest of kids and help them reach their greatest potential. Mr. Speaker, I yield the well.
Let me give you my daily instructions. When members are in the well on morning orders, I expect every member of this House that's in the chamber to give them attention and respect, and I could hardly hear the previous representative before she concluded her remarks. If you have things you need to attend to, we've got plenty of places to go and have discussions and conduct other business. But this time of day, though, members are in the well and they are to be given respect and attention as you would expect if you were in the well. Chair recognizes Chairman Benton for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the House, I want to call your attention to a birthday today. On this day in 1832, one of Georgia's most famous soldiers and statesmen was born, John B. Gordon. Georgia's man on horseback here at the Capitol, was born in Upson County. He was the fourth of 12 children. He was an outstanding student at the University of Georgia, but left before graduating. He later studied law in Atlanta and passed the bar. When the war between the states began, although lacking in military education or experience, he organized a company of soldiers out of Northwest Georgia that referred to themselves as the Raccoon Roughs. He was elected to be their captain, later promoted to Brigadier General and then Major General during the war. At the Battle of Sharpsburg, he was wounded 5 times. A mini ball passed through his calf. Second ball hit him higher on the same leg. Third ball went through his left arm. He continued to lead his men despite the fact that the muscles and tendons and arm were mangled. Fourth ball hit him in the shoulder. Despite pleas that he go to the rear, he continued to lead his men. He was finally stopped by a ball that hit him in the face, passing through his left cheek and out his jaw. He fell with his face in his cap and might have drowned in his own blood if it had not drained out through a bullet hole in his cap. After months of recuperation, he rejoined the Army of Northern Virginia and commanded a brigade at the Battle of Gettysburg. My great-great-grandfather was part of that brigade. His brigade occupied Wrightsville on the Susquehanna River, the farthest east in Pennsylvania any organized Confederate troops would reach. Starting in late 1864, he led the Second Corps of the Army of Northern Virginia until the end of the war. In this role, he defended the line in the Siege of Petersburg and commanded the attack on Fort Stedman. At Appomattox Courthouse, he led his men in the last charge of the Army of Northern Virginia. And on April the 12th, his men led the surrender of Lee's army to Grant's army. After the war, as the government of the state of Georgia was being reconstituted for a readmission to the Union, Gordon ran for governor but was defeated. He was a firm opponent of Reconstruction. He was elected to the United States Senate in 1873 and again in 1879. Became the first Confederate to preside over the U.S. Senate. He was a strong supporter of the New South and industrialization. In 1886, he was elected governor of Georgia and again in 1888. And from 1891 to 1897, he was again in the United States Senate. He was the first commander-in-chief of the United Confederate Veterans when the group was organized in 1890 and held that position until his death. He was buried at Oakland Cemetery here in Atlanta, and it is estimated that about 75,000 people viewed or took part in the memorial ceremonies. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield the well.
Chair recognizes Representative Sharper for a morning order. Representative Sharper.
Thank you, Speaker. I'm so tired of being alone. I'm so tired of on my own. Won't you help me, girl, just as soon as you can? Well, my moment in Black history spotlights Albert Green, born April 13, 1946, better known as Al Green, or Reverend Al Green, is an American singer, better known for her scoring a series of soul hit singles in the early 1970s, including Tired of Being Alone, I'm Still in Love with You, love and happiness. And his signature song, Let's Stay Together, inducted to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1995, Green was referred to on the museum site as being one of the most gifted purveyors of soul music. Green was included in the Rolling Stone list of 100 greatest artists of all times, ranking at number 66. And I'm gonna leave you guys with a little piece of one of his signature songs. I'm like this. So in love with you, whatever you want to do is all right with me. 'Cause you make me feel so brand new. And I want to spend my life with you. Al Green, everybody.
Chair recognizes Representative Buckner and others for a morning order.
I'll wait just a minute for the Dean of the House to join me. He may want to sing too. I don't know. Isn't that great? We'll let Richard sing.
We'll let Richard sing.
I believe that God's got a gift of humor.
Got a tough act to follow.
I know. The Columbus delegation is proud and excited to have with us here in their state capital the Columbus Youth Advisory Council, and they are with us here in the gallery. Let me just tell you a little bit about the group, and then we'll ask them to stand, and I'd ask you to welcome them to the house. The president of the group is Matthew Adams. If you want to, there you go, okay. From Columbus High School, where my daughter is a senior. Advisors' names are Howard Pendleton, Sandra Hunter, Lawrence Vance, Lisa Goodwin, Shanae Goodwin, Dolores Allen, Mike King, Chris Thompson, Lula Jones, and Janet Goodwin. They all represent all the schools of Muskogee County, both public and private. They are in grades 6 to 12, and we have about 60. So if you will stand, we will recognize you. Those are some of our finest from Muskogee County. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Pack for a morning order. Representative Pack.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. At this time, I would like to request the Majority Leader, the Minority Leader, Representative Moran, Representative Coleman, if he's on the floor, and anyone with a red sash to come up with me. Okay, good. Would the clerk read the caption to the resolution, please?
House Resolution on 1151 by Representative Pack, 108th, O'Neill of 146, Abrams of the 89th, Marin of the 96th, and Coleman of the 97th, commending Fred Korematsu and recognizing January 30th, 2014 as Fred Korematsu Day at the State Capitol and for other purposes.
I am an American. If there is a legacy that was left by Fred Korematsu, is that powerful statement. For those of you who are a fan of history, realize that Fred Korematsu, who was an American, refused to abide by the order requiring him to report to internment. Last year, you guys remember that we adopted a resolution honoring him on his birthday, January 30th. And this year, you were gracious enough to adopt the resolution declaring January 30th Fred Korematsu Day at the state capitol. And of course, because of the snow jam, we have gathered today to honor him. On this day, we are very fortunate to tell you that Karen Korematsu, who's the daughter of Fred Korematsu, is here with us today. Karen, would you stand to be recognized? In honor of the 2014 Asian American Legislative Day, we wanted to honor five outstanding Georgians who are contributing to our society in all walks of life, who are from the Asian American community. Well, first of all, I just introduced Karen Korematsu. Karen is a tireless advocate who's carrying on the legacy of her father with civil rights. She has flown here from California to honor this day. She is the, she co-founded the Korematsu Institute for Civil Rights and Education at the Asian Law Caucus, and she's been serving as the executive director of that institute since 2013. I also am proud to recognize Ms. Hyunjin Sun, who happens to be a Korean American and also the 2014 Gwinnett County Teacher of the Year. Ms. Sun is actually an engineering teacher at the Gwinnett School for Math, Science, and Technology. And those of you who recall the list, that's the best high school in the entire state. But more importantly, not only is she a female, she is an engineering researcher who left the lab to enter education because she felt like she hoped to inspire other females and other students going to engineering. And not only is she beloved by her students, and she's respected by her peers, as reflected in the Gwinnett County Teacher of the Year Award. There's also Officer Deepa Patel, who is the first Indian American female police officer in the entire state of Georgia. Officer Patel serves Cobb County Precinct 1, is a graduate of Georgia State University. You know, in hopes of becoming a lawyer, she spent a semester of college volunteering for a police department, and she found the right path, I guess. Wow. And she chose that this is her passion. And of her work, she states that on the streets, my race doesn't matter. To criminals, I'm just the police that they're trying to get away from. She's breaking any stereotypes and barriers, and for that, we honor her. We also are pleased to have Dr. Yassine Abu Baker, who is a successful physician of Pakistani origin, specializing in internal medicine and rheumatology. He and his wife actually founded the Saad Abu Baker Foundation in memory of their son. The foundation works to help needy families of children with special needs. In addition to rent, food, and clothing, the foundation has provided hundreds of wheelchairs, orthopedic braces, walkers, lifts, hearing aids, and eyeglasses and medical equipment to those in need. Through his work, he's contributing to the community, not just as an Asian American, but to all of Georgia. For that, we honor him. Right. And last but not least, we honor Dr. Josephine Tan, who has been a titan of the Asian American community for years. She's a business and civic leader with deep personal roots and commitment to the welfare of citizens of Georgia. She currently serves as the Georgia Powers Community Development Manager in the Metro East Region of Atlanta. She was also the chair of the Asian American Commission by Sonny Perdue. And also, she has founded the Georgia's Asian American Chamber of Commerce. And through her work, she's been recognized by the Atlanta Women Magazine as one of Georgia's 25 Power Women, named by the Atlanta Magazine as one of their top 20 women making a mark. And she's been a devoted advocate for our community and also involvement of Asian Americans in politics. For that, we honor her. Today is the Asian American Legislative Day in honoring the Fred Korematsu Day. We have a full list of events. There's the handout that I handed you yesterday, starting with, we have a policy briefing going on right now, and there's a luncheon over at the Sopi Foy building. Please stop by if you have time. And if nothing else, please, you'll see a lot of these individuals walking around with the red sash. Please stop by and say hello, and they may come and talk to you as their representative. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield the well.
This House will come to order. We're about to recognize and honor some very distinguished Georgians. Clerk will read the caption to an invite resolution.
House Resolution 1230 by Representatives Tankersley, the 160th Parish of the 158th, and Burns, the 159th, commending Georgia Southern University and inviting Dr. Brooks A. Keel to be recognized by the House of Representatives and for other purposes.
Before I introduce the representatives, we're very, very proud to have with us today the our friends from Georgia Southern University, one of the great institutions in this state. You got the president here and others. And I know they're about more than football, but y'all know I'll keep up with college football, don't you? And they had a pretty good day one Saturday last fall, and I sent one of the staff a text, and I said, you know, today we're all Eagles. It's my honor to introduce the chairman of the Intergovernmental Coordination Committee, Chairman Tankersley, for an invite resolution. She's joined by Chairman Burns, Chairman Parrish, Representative Hitchens, and the alumni of the year back there, the majority whip, Representative Ramsey.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is a great honor and privilege to be able to introduce to you today Georgia Southern University President, Dr. Brooks Keel. He's accompanied by Dr. Jean Bartels, Provost and Vice President of Academic Affairs, and GSU's interns at the Capitol, Lewis McDermott and Brittany Waters. Dr. Keel was named the 12th President of Georgia Southern by the University System Georgia's Board of Regents in 2009, and he officially began his tenure in January of 2010. Dr. Keel was born, raised, and educated in Augusta, Georgia. He's a product of education in the system of Georgia, and he has direct ties to the state and a well-rounded understanding of higher education. Before serving as president at Georgia Southern University, he served as the Vice Chancellor of Research and Economic Development at Louisiana State University in Baton Rouge. Under Dr. Keel's leadership, Georgia Southern University continues to break new ceilings, including record enrollment and economic development opportunities. The university, one of Georgia's largest, is a top choice of Georgia's Hope Scholars and is recognized for its student-centered approach to education. Georgia Southern offers 115 degree programs serving more than 20,000 undergraduates and graduate students. Now, last but not least, I must tell you the only concern local folks ever had about Dr. Keel, and that was the amount of time he spent in Louisiana. You see, they were really fearful that he would try to influence the fine Southern cuisine in Statesboro and try to change it to something like crawfish or gumbo. But you know what? They were wrong. After Georgia Southern's historic win over the University of Florida, he acquired a distinct taste for gator tails. Go Eagles. Y'all, please join me in welcoming the 12th president of one of the greatest universities in America, Dr. Keel.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and Mr. Speaker, because of your undying love for the University of Florida, I'm told we have a short video that we'd like to present with your permission.
Absolutely. Former quarterback himself playing center field, went over and knocked it out. Here it is, guys. Barring a penalty that is, 8 seconds remain. Fourth down and two at the 16-yard line. Snap the morning wag. Looking right, moving, looking, throwing, catch is made, and it's over, incomplete. Georgia Southern will win this one. The Eagles bring
I never get tired of looking at that. Mr. Speaker, Madam Speaker Pro Tem, Representatives Parrish, Burns, and Tankersley, and ladies and gentlemen of the House, I bring you greetings from the campus of Georgia Southern in Statesboro. Please first allow me to thank you for the dedicated service you all give to the great state of Georgia. We're extremely grateful to you for your timeless efforts to help make Georgia an even more productive, safe, and prosperous place to live, work, learn, and play. Georgia Southern is the largest university south of I-20, and as such, we take our mission to educate the sons and daughters of Georgia and our role to advance economic development in our region very seriously. Last year alone, we were responsible for more than $846 million in economic development to our region. We are a large, comprehensive research university, more than 20,500 students, enrolling students from all 159 counties of Georgia, from all 50 states of the Union, from over 100 countries. We offer more than 110 degree programs, including education, business, engineering, logistics, nursing, public health, computer science, and information technology, to name a few. To meet the workforce needs of Georgia for the next decade and beyond, we are looking to expand further into manufacturing engineering, video gaming and digital entertainment, graduate nursing, and geology, and we'll be enhancing our research into rural health, material science, biofuels, and STEM education. We have one of the top ROTC programs in the country, and in addition to leading the region and commissioning cadets for the Army, our ROTC program produces more ROTC nursing cadets than anyone in the country. Georgia Southern competes at the highest level of NCAA Division I sports, and as you just saw, we are the other university in the state of Georgia to beat the Florida Gators, defeating them 26-20 in the swamp. So as you can see, Georgia Southern is a large-scale, comprehensive research university dedicated to its mission of providing a quality education and in its role of developing the economy of Georgia and beyond. Thank you so much for the honor of this resolution and for allowing Georgia Southern to be a part of your day-to-day. I encourage you all to stop by the Rotunda and to witness firsthand the many wonderful things Georgia Southern has to offer. Thank you once again, and go Eagles! Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, so much. Appreciate it.
I'm here to recognize the 103rd birthday of a great American, President Ronald Reagan. His birthday is today. Many people here had the opportunity to know him. I was blessed by the opportunity to work and know him as well. And it was a distinct privilege. It was one that you actually didn't really realize what you're about doing until history has proven out the consequences. I'd like to share with you one brief quote, and then let us get on to business. President Reagan said, "Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, defended, and handed to our children to do the same, one generation at a time." That has never been more true today than ever before, and I would say probably throughout our 200 and some odd years of existence, standing up and defending our Constitution, freedom and liberty is critically important, and I just want to once again recognize President Ronald Reagan's birthday, and thank you for your indulgence. God bless you all.
Chair recognizes Representative Joyce Chandler and Chairman Brooks Coleman for an invite resolution. This House will be in order. House will be in order. Representative Chandler and Chairman Coleman.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Colleagues and friends, it is my pleasure to let you know that this week is National School Counseling Week. And we have a group of school counselors in the balcony. And included in that group of folks there are several of them, are the coordinators in Atlanta Public Schools for school counseling, Laverne Ware and Ronald Garlington, along with Mark Ellis, who is counseling coordinator in Fulton County. And Mark also has been named the school counselor supervisor for 2013, which is quite an honor in Georgia. We would like for you to stand and let us recognize you, all of you, because we have a group of distinguished counselors. Thank you for coming. These folks are in the trenches every day, and they are working with students to enhance academic achievement and career readiness. We also have a proclamation which has been signed by Governor Deal indicating that this week is School Counseling Week in Georgia. And it is my privilege to present this proclamation to Julie Spires, who is a high school counselor from Glenn County and also president of the Georgia School Counselors Association. Thank you, Julie.
Thank you.
Each year, the American School Counselor Association indicates one counselor from around the United States to be designated as National Counselor of the Year. And since 2009, Georgia has had three of those designations, which is quite an accomplishment. And we have three of those ladies with us today. First of all, Julie Hartline. And Julie, if you'll raise your hand. Julie was a high school counselor in Cobb. She now is in the central office. She was counselor of the year, National Counselor of the Year in 2009. We have Nicole Weber with us. And Nicole was the National Counselor of the Year in 2012, and she is an elementary counselor in Cobb County. And then we have Jennifer Diaz. Jennifer, if you'll indicate who you are. Jennifer is an elementary counselor in Gwinnett, and she is Georgia's Counselor of the Year this year, and we believe she's going to be National Counselor of the Year in 2014. And Chairman Coleman will come and introduce the 2014 National Counselor of the Year.
Thank you so much, Mr. Speaker. Thank you, Representative Chandler. Could we have the title of the resolution read by the clerk, please? Yes, she's ready. Okay.
House Resolution 1242 by Representative Chandler of the 105th, Coleman of the 97th, Clark of the 101st, Lindsay of the 54th, Rutledge of the 109th, and others, commending Robert Zorn, recognizing the week of February 3rd through 7th as National School Counseling Week, and inviting Robert Zorn to be recognized by the House of Representatives and for other purposes.
Thank you so much, Mr. Clerk. It's my pleasure today to stand here and to introduce to you a very, very special person. All of us, When we attended schools, you know, the counselors touched us very closely. If it hadn't been for good counselors, many of us wouldn't be where we are today. Thank God there was some there to help me out. I'll tell you that. But Robin Zorn is a school counselor at Dr. Miles Mason Jr. Elementary School in Duluth, Georgia. She's been named, and listen to this, the 2014 National. She was Georgia and National School Counselor of the Year. The award presented by the American School Counselors Association honors professionals who devote their careers to serving as advocates and often lifesavers for the nation's students. Robin, a school counselor since 1994, is continually looking for ways, new and innovative ways, to support students and teachers and make Mason Elementary School the best place in the nation to be. She does an exceptional job. Robin has her husband. She's married to Bob Zorn, and he's a counselor of 19 years. He's a counselor at Hull Middle School, and her school feeds them, so they get that continuation of good counseling support. She has two beautiful children, Anna Lynn and Mary Taylor. One's a high school student, and the other's a middle school student. Does a great job, and I want y'all to welcome her to the podium. She's going to say a few words. Let's give her a great welcome here to the house.
Good morning and happy National School Counselors Week. As they mentioned, I have the honor of bringing the 2014 National School Counselor of the Year Award to Georgia. And as Representative Chandler mentioned, of the 7 years that we have had a National School Counselor recognize just one, Georgia has brought home three of those awards. Last week, I had the privilege of being sent to Washington, D.C. with my principal to participate in the National School Counselor of the Year events. We had the opportunity of visiting the Senate and the House floor. We met with Senator Chambliss and Isaacson. And the counselors in other states kept asking about the great work that we're doing in the state of Georgia. And I said, it's because we have the best legislators in the whole United States. So, our legislators recognize the importance of school counselors and that it's important to have school counselors in the school. Our legislators are proactive, and our legislators recognize that students will stay in school and they will be college and career ready after graduation when they are being part of a comprehensive school counseling program. So I'd like to say my appreciation once again for passing House Bill 283, which lowers the student-to-counselor ratio. Thank you. At this time, on behalf of the Georgia School Counselors Association and our president, Julie Spires, we would like to present Representative Brooks Coleman with a plaque of appreciation in his continuing support of school counselors in Georgia. Representative Chandler and Senator Wilkinson received their awards back in November at our fall conference. Thank you.
Thank you. Chair recognizes Representative Caldwell for an invite resolution. Representative Caldwell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Okay, if all the members and the guests in the gallery could do me a quick favor. If you descend from British lineage, do me a favor and raise your hand.
That includes Scotland.
That includes Scotland. Okay. My father was born in England. I'm a dual citizen with the United States and the United Kingdom. It's my great honor today. I hope you saw on your desks you have some flag pins I'd ask you to wear those proudly today. It is UK Day at the Capitol today. It's my honor to introduce Her Majesty's Consul General, Mr. Jeremy Pillmore Bedford.
Thank you very much. It's really great to be here.
Well, let me begin by thanking Speaker David Ralston for inviting me here today, but also Representative Michael Caldwell for sponsoring the resolution today, as well as all of the rest of you here in the House, both for the UK Day in the Capitol, but also for allowing me to speak here. The Englishman George Bernard Shaw once said that the United States and Great Britain were two great countries separated by a common language. I hope today that I can bridge that separation despite my foreign accent. It really is a great honor to be here today, and thank you for recognizing the strong relationship between the United States and the United Kingdom, and particularly those between the United Kingdom and the great state of Georgia. This is especially important as we near one of the biggest cultural anniversaries between our nations, the 50th anniversary of the British invasion in February the 9th. The Beatles' US tour truly cemented US-UK music friendship, and that continues to flourish today. In fact, Otis Redding, a Georgia native, was said to be greatly influenced by the Beatles' album, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. And he was so liked by the Beatles that they sent him a limo to pick him up when he first performed in London. Now, if I could sing like the representative who sang earlier this morning, I would break into a Beatles number. But I think you'll all be very relieved to know that I can't sing, so I won't even try. However, on a serious note, we would love for anyone who can to come and join in the Beatles tribute at Hendershot's in Athens, Georgia, on February the 18th, from 7:30 in the evening till 10 p.m. However, the UK and the US not only have strong cultural ties, our countries are also strong commercial partners in the global marketplace. Historically, trade with Georgia and the Southeast has been very important for the UK. In fact, the British Consulate Office has been in Atlanta for more than 60 years and over a century in Georgia. There are more than 200 UK companies in Georgia with almost 900 facilities. Some of you would never guess, like Holiday Inn, which is owned by Intercontinental Hotels. In total, British companies employ an estimated 60,000 Georgians and invest about $6.6 billion in the state. The UK is also, we believe, the best place to do business in Europe. The IMF predicts that the UK will have the fastest growth in the EU in 2014 at 2.4%. coming on top of an already 1.9% growth last year. And by April 2015, we will have the lowest business tax in the G20, and the government is cutting red tape and regulation to aid business. As Her Majesty's Consul General, I hope to continue strengthening our trade relationships in the coming years. Part of this is getting out and getting to know you all better. So please feel free to reach out to my office and to me, and if we can be of any service to you and to companies in Georgia. Thank you again for this flattering opportunity and this resolution, and let's keep the UK-US ties, and especially those in the Southeast, strong and productive. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much. Thank you. An honor. Chair recognizes for a morning order Representative Ballinger.
Real brief, I just wanted to recognize Clark Creek Elementary is here. If y'all will stand up and be recognized by the Georgia House. Thanks, y'all.
Chair recognizes for a morning order Representative Chuck Williams and Representative Regina Quick for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, I have a subject that is a serious subject. that I want to share with you this morning. And this is not just for the guys in the room that are over 50, even though it certainly applies to us, Mr. Leader. But it's for those guys that one day will be 50, and it's also for the ladies who have husbands or fathers or children at home. What I want to talk to you about for a moment is the subject of prostate cancer. We know that we have survivors in this very body of this disease. We know that we have lost members of this body to this disease. This is not Prostate Cancer Awareness Month. I think that is September, but since we're not in session in September, we're declaring today Prostate Cancer Awareness Day in Georgia. You notice the bracelets on your desk. Everybody's got the blue bracelets. I hope everybody recognizes the symbolism of the blue color, because for those of us who have been to see our doctor and had the PSA test and the other tests, you might recognize that this is the color of those beloved gloves that we see. In the gallery is a friend of ours, Kurt Gelfand, and his wife Pat. Kurt is a cancer survivor, a business owner in our community, an advocate for prostate cancer screening. And I just wanted to ask Kurt and Pat if they would stand, and let's recognize the work they're doing to recognize this. Thank you.
All right, we're about to go on to the rules calendar. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 786. House Bill 786.
House Bill 786 by Representative Knight of the 130th to amend Article 1, Chapter 2, Title 27, the Official Code of Georgia, annotated relating to hunting, trapping, or fishing licenses. This bill having come before the Committee on Game, Fish, and Parks, the committee recommends the same do pass and be read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Knight to present the bill. Chairman Knight.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and members of the House. I come before you today to offer House Bill 786. You know, we're all the time, and you've seen me up here before, we're all the time looking for ways to encourage and promote our hunting and fishing, the enjoyment of our great outdoors, especially the state of Georgia and its diverse habitat. And as such, I'm bringing this bill before you. This bill primarily does two things. The first thing is it does away with the residency requirements for a infant lifetime license. Again, I want to state that, infant lifetime license. In other words, from birth up to the age of 2 years of age, okay? And we're doing this to help encourage. We've got a lot of folks who have relatives that are outside the state, and this is a good way for that aunt, uncle, and grandparents to be encouraged to give that conservation gift to that newborn and hopefully get them started out on the right foot. The second thing this does is I think it simplifies the process by which we have to prove residency in the state of Georgia. You know, beforehand, you had to send in things like tax returns or registration, warranty deeds to property. As everyone knows, especially ones who've tried to get a driver's license lately in the state of Georgia, that process is much more controlled, and we can now rely on the Department of Driver Services and for that license. So now the requirement for that residency requirement is a driver's license. And if you don't have a driver's license, you can go get a photo ID identification card from the DDS, and that will simply apply. That's basically what the bill does. There's some other changes as the legal counsel cleaned up some language in there, and I'll be happy to answer any questions on that bill. But again, I want to ask for your support. Another good conservation measure as we seek to encourage youth to enjoy the great heritage we have here in Georgia.
You have some questions if you care to yield.
Yes, sir, I will.
Chair recognizes Chairman Pruitt to your right for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Did the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
If I recall, and I have done this for several years, this is the gift that I give my grandchildren when they're born, but you have to have a Social Security number in the past. Is that still the case?
As far as the residency requirements, let me look on this, Representative Pruitt, Chairman Pruitt. I'm sure you still have to have a Social Security number, if I'm not mistaken, but the proof of residency that I'm going over is now no longer the other documents.
Right.
I'm not mistaken in there, Social Security is still... Obviously, if you go get a license today, anyone in the state of Georgia, there is a Social Security that is required. But I think what I was referring to, and I hope we don't get it confused, is when we're proving residency in the state of Georgia, now we're relying on that driver's license, which, as you know, is pretty tough to get a driver's license nowadays.
It is. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Will you have one more question?
Yes, sir.
Also, isn't it true that if you buy a lifetime license, that we get money from the federal government every year from then on, as long as that license is in effect, and that would be a tremendous help to the DNR here in Georgia?
That is true.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You have some other questions if you care to yield.
Yes, sir.
Chair recognizes the chairman of the committee from which the bill came, Chairman Burns, for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Just a quick question. And a kind of a follow-up on the chairman's question over here. The fiscal impact on our state and on DNR as we work to enhance that part of our business, what kind of impact will this bill and this privilege have on that issue?
And it's a great question, and as a follow-up to Chairman Pruitt and expanding on that. First of all, when you buy a lifetime license at the infant level, it's $200. And anytime we get a lifetime license in, that money goes into a trust fund at the state. And we get to have the interest off of that for the lifetime of that person with the lifetime license. So, and I think the actuarial tables are up to like 70 years of age, somewhere in there. So for, that infant, we get 70 years worth of interest off of that while still retaining the principal. So that's one good thing. The second thing, and a repeat to, I think, a clarification of Chairman Pruitt in his comments was, and you've heard me talk about this before, is the Pittman-Robinson Federal Aid Wildlife Act. This goes back to 1939, and the Dingell-Johnson Act, which is 1950. These are where you and I, as hunters, fishers, when we go out and buy that rod and reel, the boat, the handgun, the shotgun, ammunition, there's an excise tax that we as hunters pay, okay, through the purchase of this equipment. And that goes up and is sits inside the Department of the Interior, and it's allocated back to the states, again, based on one of the major calculations is the number of license. So right now it's about $40-something a person, and you're right, we will continue to get that to be reinvested in our wildlife and our fisheries. So it is a great, great deal for the state of Georgia. Mr. Speaker, I don't know if there's any more questions, but
You have more questions if you care to yield.
I'll take one or two more, Mr. Speaker.
Okay, Chair recognizes Representative Dickey to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does gentleman yield?
I do.
Would this license be good for the northern zone or the southern zone?
It's all of it, my friend. All of it, my friend.
Well, would it allow this infant to be able to hunt over bait or not?
I think that depends on which side of the line you're on.
Thank you. Just wanted that clarification.
Peach outlook okay this year? Mr. Speaker, with that, I'm going to ask for everyone's favorable consideration, and please, I appreciate your past support and your continued support as we seek to promote the great resources that we have in Georgia and recruit new folks and young people to hunting and fishing. Thank you.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 786 will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the passage of House Bill 786, the ayes are 170, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 809. House Bill 809.
House Bill 809 by Representative Williams in the 115th, to amend Chapter 1 of Title 10 of the Official Code of Georgia, annotated relating to selling and other practices so as to prohibit bad faith assertions of patent infringement. This bill having come before the Committee on Banks and Banking, the committee recommends the same do pass and be read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Representative Williamson to present the bill. Representative Williamson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen in the House, I bring today for your consideration LC 390581S as a substitute to House Bill 809. This legislation amends our Fair Business Practices Act of 1975 to prohibit bad faith assertions of patent infringement claims. Now, this is a pro-business, pro-consumer legislation, and it's derived from a National Council of State Governments model bill. What it does is it brings to a stop the practice commonly known as patent trolling. In recent years, Georgia businesses have been plagued with very vaguely worded demand letters from faceless companies alleging that patents are being unlawfully used by small to medium-sized Georgia businesses. Now, these demand letters rarely include the patent number, never have the patent owner's contact information, and never fully described exactly how the targeted business is being infringed upon on the patent. So what I'm saying is they never tell you what you're doing wrong. These threatening demand letters always offer an opportunity to the target business to purchase a license, i.e. a toll fee. Due to the fear of litigation costs, many businesses simply send the troll their money. And what our businesses don't realize is that's the last thing that the trolls really want. They want this cash stream to keep on coming in. If they go to court, they incur litigation costs. They don't want to do it either, but our small to medium-sized Georgia businesses don't understand that fact. In fact, one toll targets Georgia businesses that use software that converts incoming faxes to emails. That's something that's very prevalent amongst businesses, but these trolls are just targeting certain ones. Another troll specializes in terrorizing our high-tech digital printing industries over various printing techniques, such as the QR, quick response codes, scanning, and computer printing workflow technology. And Sir Thomas Carlyle once said, sarcasm is the language of the devil. So forgive me if I use some of this language when I say that my favorite troll scam in Georgia is the one that demands that our community banks and credit unions pay a toll every time an ATM connects to an internet. Just think about that. So it's very important to understand that this legislation does nothing to stop legitimate patent claims. It's extremely important that Georgia patents be protected. And this legislation does enjoy the business and legal community support from both the business and legal community. And I've heard absolutely no opposition. It is endorsed by the Technology Association of Georgia and the Georgia Chamber of Commerce. And the bottom line is we need to stop these trolls from sitting on the bridge to innovation in Georgia, so I'd ask for your favorable consideration of this legislation.
You have questions. Do you yield?
Yes, sir, I do.
Chair recognizes Representative Fleming to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. That was an excellent quote from Sir Thomas Carlyle. Do you by any chance know what year he said that?
And I'm a Carlinian scholar, but I don't quite have the dates down. Thanks for the question. I need to get out of here. He didn't tell me to. No further questions?
Chair recognizes. Do you further yield?
Yes, sir.
Chair recognizes Representative Frazier to your right for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am. I'm always honored to yield from the gentlelady from Burke County.
Thank you. Isn't it true that a lot of our small businesses are having problems paying these demand letter fees, and would this legislation protect them against these scam artists?
Yes, ma'am. In short, that will stop the scam.
Thank you.
With that, Mr. Speaker, I'll yield the will.
Gentleman has yielded the will. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 809 will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 809. The ayes are 169, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 791. House Bill 791.
House Bill 791 by Representative Stevens, 164th, to amend Code Section 48-7-40.1 of the Official Code of Georgia, annotated relating to tax credits for business enterprises in less development areas. This bill having come before the Committee on Economic Development and Tourism, the committee recommends the same do pass and be read for the third time.
Chair recognizes the Chairman of the Economic Development and Tourism Committee, Chairman Stevens, to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, 10 years ago, We passed a bill that gave economic opportunity for these depressed areas that are adjacent to military areas. We call these now designated military zones. Unfortunately, the way the bill was drawn is that if in the areas of a, when a new census is taken, it's possible, and it has happened, that a strip of land can come in and remove these designated military zones and these depressed areas from this designation. So all this bill does is correct it and says very simply that if you've ever been a military zone and you still have the poverty rate, that you can't be removed from this military zone. I'll accept any questions if there are any.
You have no questions.
I yield the well. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 791 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 791. The ayes are 168, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 800. House Bill 800.
House Bill 800 by Representative Shaw of 176th, to provide that future elections for the office of probate judge of Lanier County shall be nonpartisan elections. This bill having come before the Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination, the committee recommends the same do pass and be read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Representative Shaw to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, members of the House. House Bill 800 is just a nonpartisan bill to change the probate court, probate judge in Lanier County to a nonpartisan position. And if there are any questions, I'll yield the will. Sam.
You have a question. Do you yield?
Yes, sir.
Chair recognizes Representative Smith to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much. One question with respect to this nonpartisan status. Are we saying that the voters can vote for any candidate, or are we saying that the candidate that they actually vote for will not be representing either the Republican or the Democratic Party?
Yeah, we're saying that the candidate does not have to declare a party. It'd be a nonpartisan election.
So the candidate does not have to declare a party?
That's correct.
So the voters can vote for either a Republican or a Democrat?
That's correct. They can vote for the person. They don't have to decide what party they vote for.
Thank you. No further questions.
Yes, sir. Mr. Speaker, I yield the well.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 800 will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 800. The ayes are 108, the nays are 56. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 740. House Bill 740.
House Bill 740 by Representative Tanner of the 9th. To amend Code Section 27-1-2 of the Official Code of Georgia annotated relating the definitions regarding game and fish. This bill having come before the Committee on Game, Fish, and Parks, the committee recommends the same do pass and be read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Representative Tanner to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the House, I come to you to ask for favorable consideration for House Bill 740. I live in an area where many of my constituents are either serving our country on active duty in the military or they have family members stationed around the world protecting our freedom. I know many of you have similar situations. I want to specifically thank Representative Al Williams for his help on the bill. I know he represents the district with the highest percentage of military personnel of any district in the state. Many of the families find themselves stationed at bases outside of Georgia, but they grew up here in our state enjoying the great outdoors and the many natural resources we have. The bill I bring before you today is a result of family members approaching me about the expense incurred by these active duty military personnel attempting to buy an in-state hunting license here in Georgia and having to pay the out-of-state rate. I've worked with the Department of Natural Resources who support this bill, and the bill that I have before you today would allow anyone serving on active duty to purchase a hunting license or a fishing license in our state at paying the in-state rate, regardless of whether they're stationed here in Georgia or somewhere else across the world. Not only will this directly benefit a group of individuals that are giving much to our nation, but will also encourage more people to get outside and enjoy Georgia's many resources. With that, Mr. Speaker, I ask for the House favorable consideration for House Bill 740.
You have a question. Do you yield?
Yes, sir.
Chair recognizes Representative Al Williams to your left for a question.
Will the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
Is it not true that this bill not only is a way of saying thank you to active duty military people, but a great morale booster, and many of these people include our wounded warriors?
Yes, sir, it does. Thank you.
You have another question or two if you yield?
Yes, sir.
Chair recognizes Representative Dickey to your left for a question.
Mr. Speaker, does Jimmin yield?
Yes, sir, I do.
Does this bill allow these servicemen to be able to hunt in the northern zone or the southern zone?
This will allow our military personnel to hunt anywhere in the great state of Georgia.
Will it allow them to hunt over bait anywhere in the great state of Georgia?
Not unless it's already allowed under the law.
Do you think that's fair?
I do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. I yield.
Mr. Speaker, with that, I better yield the well. Thank you.
Wise move. Gentlemen, has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 740 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 740. The ayes are 169, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. We're about to take up announcements, but we also have motions. We've still got business to to take care of. And we're going to try to, I know we've got a lot of groups here waiting on you, but this is kind of what happens when we don't get onto the rules calendar till 11:25. So what purpose does the chairman of the rules committee rise?
Like to make a motion, please.
State your motion.
I move to recommit House Bill 773 from the rules calendar for Friday, February the 6th, to the rules committee.
Clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 773 by Dickey, the 140th, to amend Part 1 of Article 4, Chapter 11 of Title 16 of the Official Code of Georgia, annotated relating to general provisions relative to dangerous instrumentalities and practices.
On the motion of the Rules Committee Chairman that House Bill 773 be recommitted to the Rules Committee, is there objection? Chair hears none, and it is so ordered. House will continue to be in order. House will continue to be of order. What purpose does the chairman of the Ethics Committee rise?
Parliamentary inquiry, Mr.
State Speaker. State your inquiry.
Mr. Speaker, would you, may I respectfully ask you to have the clerk read House Rule 133.
You have that right. The clerk will read.
When the question is put, every member within the chamber shall vote unless the member is immediately and particularly interested therein, or unless the member is excused by the House. A motion by a member to be excused from voting must be made before the House divides or before the call of the yeas and nays is commenced, and it shall be decided without debate. The member making the motion may briefly state the reason why it should prevail. In every case where the seat of the member is being contested, the sitting member and the contestant shall both retire from the House before that vote is taken.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. All right, we have announcements. We have announcements. Let me ask those that have announcements to be making their way toward the front of the chamber. Well, they're already here. Chair recognizes the chairman of the Transportation Committee, Chairman Roberts, for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The House, full House Transportation Committee will meet today at 2 o'clock. In room 506 of the CLOB, we're going to take up House Bill 775 again. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes the Chairman of the Motor Vehicles Committee, Chairman Rice, for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The full Motor Vehicles Committee will meet in room 506 at 3 o'clock, taking up three bills.
Chair recognizes Representative Frazier for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Georgia Work and Family Legislative Caucus will meet at 12 o'clock in room 307 at CLOB, Georgia Working Family Caucus. Thank you.
Chair recognizes the Chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, Chairman Chanel, for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The full Ways and Means Committee will meet today at 3 o'clock in 606 CLOB.
Chair recognizes the Chairman of the Retirement Committee, Chairman Battles, for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Subcommittee of Ad Valorem, of Ways and Means of Ad Valorem Tax will meet at 1 o'clock. We have two bills to take up, so it's 1 o'clock and 1:33.
Chair recognizes the Governor's Floor Leader, Representative Riley, for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Environmental Quality Subcommittee of the Natural Resources and Environment Committee will meet today at 2 p.m. in room 415. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Clerk will read the caption to a group of privileged resolutions.
following three invite resolutions to be read and referred to the Committee on Rules, commending Senator Saxby Chambliss, inviting him to be recognized by the House of Representatives, commending the Georgia State Defense Force, and inviting John DeRuppi, Melanie Dallas, Anthony Rollins, and others, commending Brooke Rucker, and inviting her to be recognized by the House of Representatives. Commending and recognizing Karen Yvonne Fountain and North Star Outreach. Acknowledging the struggles that women with heart disease face every day, recognizing February 7th as National Wear Red Day. Commending the Building Owners and Managers Association of Georgia. Recognizing the 30th anniversary Heritage Sandy Springs. Commending the Eagles Landing Christian Academy Lady Chargers softball team. Honoring Bertha Mae Swan on her birthday. Honoring a life and memory of Willie James Bubba Easter. Recognizing, commending the Oconee County Quiz Bowl team on becoming the 2013 national champions. Recognizing, commending William Grant Burnett. Recognizing, commending the St. Philip African Methodist Episcopal Church. Honoring a life and memory of Mrs. Evelyn Gibson Lowry. Completes the reading of the resolutions.
Is there any objection to adopting the privilege resolutions? The chair hears none, and the resolutions are adopted.